Hello and welcome. This is Camille Fairborn from Michigan State University, and I'd like to welcome you to today's CAUSE Teaching and Learning webinar. I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Karsten Lupke as our presenter today. He is a professor at the FOM University of Applied Sciences in Germany, which has over 30 study centers in Germany and Austria. For today's webinar, he will give a presentation entitled Causal Inference, Why We Should and How We Can Teach It in Introductory Courses. The way the webinars work is that all listeners are muted during the webinar. You can ask questions at any time by typing them into the questions box. We'll be sure to ask those questions towards the end and give our presenter a chance to respond. You can also use the chat box if you're having any technical questions. At this point, I'll turn things over to our presenter. Karsten, go ahead.
Yeah, thanks, Camille, for those nice introductions, and thanks for you to attend this webinar in this challenging time. And I think this challenging times also should let us think what we may do better in our professional life. And I will come back to this later. To give you a feeling about the audience which I am lecturing, it is about data literacy. There are a lot of definitions of data literacy. I've taken the one of the EDC. And what are we aiming at? And I think the important part is, finding meaning in data, as well as taking action based on data. This is what, let's say, society is expecting from our students. And as I think most of you are very familiar with statistics, you know that this is a problem. Taking action based on data will mean that we will change the joint distribution. So, some lessons you may already know, and the main claim I would say is that for our introductory courses, that directed acyclic graphs may help to develop a framework to think about the data generating process. Why is this important? Well, the data is not just there. I mean, it has a generating process, and we all know that, but unfortunately, we seem to forget sometimes that the data generating process is important for the conclusions that we can draw from data. And well, let's see. A real data example, and I guess a lot of you are familiar with this, is from Dick DeVoe, Data Science for All. It's on house prices. And a simple scatter plot shows us, okay, the house price depends on the number of bedrooms. Fair enough. Depends, there is an association. That's important. So if we do some very simple linear regression model, we will end up that the estimated coefficients for the slope for bedrooms is something like $50,000, something like that. Okay. So I'm a poor professor and I only got two bedrooms. So what is the price of my house according to this model? Conditional on my two bedrooms, the point estimate is something like $156,000. So we are aiming at finding meaning in data, taking action based on data. So we all know that this is wrong, but okay, why not just split one bedroom into three? So I rebuilt my house and now I've got four bedrooms and the estimated value of my house goes up for something like $100,000. This example is quite simple. We know that this is wrong. Why? And this is a very simplified causal model, and it's the first duck you will see in this webinar. The number of bedrooms depends, in a way, on the living area as well as the price. And well, this is confounding or lurking. And if we adjust for living area, we will end up where the estimate of our bedrooms is negative. This is a continuous version of the Simpsons paradox. But the question is, how can we teach this in class? Because this is a simple example we can understand. But what in big data situations or something like that, where we may not understand the problem that easy? And I was trained as a statistician, and I got my PhD in statistical meta learning. And I'd say, okay, I don't care. Just use some fancy machine learning methods, put all variables in, and let the computer do the thinking. Of course, I know of bias variance trade-off and all this stuff. But unfortunately, which was, I must admit, new for me, that cross-validated mean squared error on stuff like this do not tell us which model is best. As you can see in this very simple simulated example, and in the current COVID-19 situation, you've seen a lot of examples of this problem. Assume you date someone because he's good looking and because he's kind, and moreover, assume that looking and kindness are independent. Well, that's a model. Here is the data generating process. You don't have to care about the math too much or the R code. It's just an illustrative example. What is happening? Marginally, of course, by construction, look and kindness are independent. No correlation between those two. But what is happening if you're adjusting for dating? If you're adjusting for dating, you will end up in Bergson's paradox, because kind and look are marginally independent, but conditional on dating, not independent at all. That's a problem. And to make it even worse, if you select only those you dated, you will get an association. And we've got this problem currently in COVID-19 testing. There is somehow a reason why you are testing. And as being tested is the effect of some other reasons, there is, or there may be, a bias in our data. By the way, as you haven't seen me, I'm there, and I've got the luck that I could work with kind and good-looking people who also contributed. So there they are. They're not all from the FOM. Gero, for example, is from the Hochschule Stralsund, and Jörg is from the University of Bielefeld, and this is my dean, Bianca. So this is a joint work with a lot of nice and good-looking people. So some more words about data science, statistics, and causal inferences. What do we want to do with the data? What are we aiming at? And these two papers are, for me, a must read, so to say, for everyone who's involved in teaching statistics or data science. Do we want to explain, or do we want to predict? And maybe nowadays we want to do causal inference. And Judea Pearl established somehow a three-level hierarchy. And in our normal lectures, we normally just deal with the association. What is the probability of Y given that we observe X? But as far as we are taking action based on data, we intervene. We manipulate X. We set X to X. And of course, in this situation, I'm here now, sorry. In this situation, we are changing the joint distribution. Because X is now on a point, has got a point mass on the value of X. That is something different. And what Pearl actually did, that he established some do calculus, that is a mass to calculate this distribution, the distribution of Y given that we do X. Of course, there are assumptions on this and so on, and you can't always do it, but there are situations where you can actually do it. And what I find quite interesting, this is also linked to partial dependence plots, which are quite famous in explainable machine learning. Okay, and the last hierarchy of causal inference is the counterfactual, and that is imagining what if I had acted differently. And this is where the discrimination part comes in. Because there are different concepts of algorithmic fairness, but for me, one of the most easiest to grasp is a counterfactual fairness, which means, okay, I'm a male, would I have got my job if I would have been a female? And of course, also there are a lot of assumptions to calculate it, but under these assumptions, you actually can. Of course, there are other approaches, potential outcome frameworks, you name it, you've got it. And also maybe for teaching Kornfield's conditions and the Bradford Hill criteria. But I mean, due to the limited time, I will stick to this. So here's a very, very, very short page of theory. In order to construct such a graph, you say X and an arrow pointing to Y, you just say that Y is some kind of function and some exogenous U. It's not limited to the linear case. It can be non-parametrically, you name it, you've got it. But for teaching, I will come back to that later, we just use a very simple linear case. And what does it mean? Well, the value of Y depends on X, but not the other way around. And well, when I grow up, my weight grows, but nowadays, unfortunately, if I put on weight, my height stays the same. And even though graphs can be quite complicated, there are three basic elements within this. There's a chain where C, the covariate, is just a mediator. There's a fork where C is a cause of both of X and Y. And there's a collider where C is the effect of both. In the first example of the Zaragoza houses from Dick DeVoe, C was the house size, which was the cause of number of rooms, as well as house price. In the very simple simulated example I've just given, C was the dating, was the effect of good looking and kindness. And if we adjust, however we do that, if we adjust here for C, we are blocking the causal path from X to Y. Here, blocking is a very good idea because we are blocking the non-causal path. And here, unfortunately, we are opening a biasing path. By the way, if you actually want to do it, Dagerty is an excellent tool to construct this, such graphs. And moreover, this in my experience, I must admit. There's still so much more to learn about all this, and especially in the teaching situation. This is what actually happens if you do a randomized controlled trial. You cut the arrow from the covariate to your treatment. X is no longer listening on C, X is listening to you, your experimentic. And that is what the do operator does, in a way. This is about randomized controlled trial. And actually, this is a very simple example, but I start my very first lecture with this. I ask student, what can you do to get a good grade, have a high test score? And normally they end up with something like learning time. And then I do, yeah, but well, here, let's say, Camille is so clever, she doesn't have to learn. What will happen? And we've got very engaging and I think fruitful discussions. So what shall I say about teaching, or can I say about teaching all this stuff? Jeff Widmer has written to us that we as statistics educators can and should do better in teaching causal inference. Okay, but, and I admit it's true. I mean, I always tell, oh, correlation does not imply causation, but it gets lost somewhere. And I've given, I think, a dozen talks in Germany about statistics education. So I always cited George Kopp. Here, I cite him with this, mere renovation is too little too late. We need to rethink our undergraduate curriculum from ground up. And I don't know, still don't know whether it was a good idea or a bad idea, but we did, based on your work. We focused on the statistical thinking empirical inquiry, and then we combined it all with a linear model. Because, well, you need some space or time to teach causal inference, and it must fit in the curriculum. For computation and reproducibility and so on, we use a mosaic package, which is for us quite simple to use in class. And great work of you, we use a simulation-based inference. And you will get the slides and you will get the open access materials later on, and you can follow all the links. And there are a lot of good books around: Open Intro, Modern Dive, Statistical Modeling, also Data 8. So, well, thank you. I don't know if any one of the mentioned persons is listening, but you've done a wonderful job. So we reshaped our curriculum according to this, so that causal inference fits in, I must say. But I'm still unsure for the discussion. Is it a good idea with oversimplified examples? Are we overstraining? Simulated data. I mean, we always think that real life data is better. And yes, we are omitting a lot of consensus stuff if we just follow this ideas. Is this a good idea? But on the other hand, good questions, as Alan Rossmann says, is brilliant. What are the important questions? Nowadays, in a world full of multivariate observational data, I feel, but maybe you convince me that I was wrong, that causal thinking with ducks and so on may help in the modern world. So I'm here to finish. Of course, there's much more. So this is the intro literature. If you want to spend more for causal inference, there's you can read a very lot of things. R packages exist, also Python packages and so on. I don't really care. I was very pleased to introduce our work, which is also published in the Journal of Statistics Education, and later on we will hopefully publish some more work on this. The material for this webinar, as well as an intro course I gave for data scientists. So it's not the actual lecture materials I use in class, because they are in German, but for data scientists, I did it in English, are available under GitHub. It would be very nice if you'll find any errors and flaws if you let me know. And I hope I'm on time. What was my main topic? I think we can and should help students to develop a framework to think more clearly about the data generating process in a world full of multivariate observational data. In case you were interested more in the causal inference than in the teaching aspect, you can do a lot of things with it, but of course you must always remember what are you aiming at. So thank you very much.
And thank you as well for this very interesting webinar. We have a lot of questions. One comes from Henry Rivera, who says, what is your experience dealing with statistics department leaders in changing to this new approach?
A very good question. Actually, we committed ourselves for the data literacy. Hernan has written an excellent paper on this topic. Now is the time for a changing curriculum, and I am so lucky that my dean is a very nice and a friendly person, so we got accepted at our universities. But of course, as I said, and this is a serious question, is it a good idea to teach something that most of us have not learned as a student? I don't know if it's a good idea, because there may be flaws, but I think the statistics community is getting more open to causal inference. That's my feeling.
All right. We have another question from Andrew Ross. He says, how often are the conditions right in observational data for us to be able to infer causation from it? If it's quite often, then it has a higher chance of being useful to intro stats students. If it's not so common, then maybe it's not so useful in intro stats. What's your opinion on that?
I definitely agree. But to cite Hernan again, I actually like the idea to draw your assumptions encoded in this graph before communicating your conclusions. Actually, there are testable implications There are testable implications of a causal model. But if they are true or not, we don't know, unfortunately. But if we are interested in actions based on data, and there's always a chance, if possible, to do a randomized controlled trial, then we are more certain than in other situations. But it's a good point.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, we all I think all of us have at least said the words association is not causation, as we've taught an intro stat class. But to be able to not just leave it there and say, you know, but when can it be? I mean, other if it's never, then you don't ever learn anything about the world. And
Maybe I can just add one more note on this. We did, or we are currently doing a study where we show people a normal regression table and ask them what they conclude from that data. And then whether, you know, there is a causal inference possible or not. And I would say the result is somehow randomized in real life. And then we show the graph where a causal conclusion is possible, and more people come to the correct causal conclusion, but still some say, oh no, we can't do it. So it's funny and interesting.
And then I guess if you had just one piece of advice for how to introduce causal inference, is there like a favorite example of yours or a favorite resource that you felt like really helped you get your brain around how to introduce this in an intro stat class? Is there a paper or a book or something that you could point us to?
I like especially, I mean, Kevin Kominski has done a, and colleagues done a brilliant example. It's published. And the first three references are quite easy to read, I would say.
Okay.
And there are very good examples. I won't say that my are quite good as well, but at least I find them quite helpful. And as you can see, they are available on GitHub. Where and I actually start with in class. I start with this example with simulated data.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I think those graphs are very, very interesting and helpful.
Yeah. Well, at least maybe I may add. Of course, there are, we should do a lot of more research. And at the ECOT, there were some very interesting posters and presentations on multivariate thinking. We've done it twice so far, or three times. So we are still learning what students really understand and what they don't understand, and so on and so on. So this is, we started the journey. We haven't finished yet.
I have one more question for you, and this is just my question. You mentioned that you had to remove some topics from your intro stat class to include more causal inference. What did you remove?
Well, we basically put the testing in the linear model framework. So we mention, as Kopp said in his brilliant paper, there is a t-test, there is the ANOVA, there is the you name all these testing procedures, but they are in the appendix. And compared to others, we put also the data wrangling, the data, you know, the data scraping and so on. We put it more in the appendix of the lecture.
Okay.
So. And also, you know, we don't Gauss test or U test or something. We don't do that any longer. So we integrated all in a kind of linear modeling approach with simulation-based inference.
Okay. And then I guess one more question. Have you had any struggles convincing other colleagues, not just your leadership, but other colleagues to also buy into this different way of thinking?
Sure, but we do a lot of teaching, train the trainers, we call it, I think. I don't really know. So we introduce them with a concept, and of course there are colleagues who say no, I mean, if I don't teach my normal table, I'm not satisfied. And problems are actually not, oh well, what should we all do, but what are the, is the price for doing something, what are the opportunity costs, what do we omit? But I think, at least for me and for many colleagues, this causal thinking is quite convincing. If
yes.
you, yes. So we are quite satisfied so far. But of course, there's always, and there are good reasons not to do it. I mean, there are good reasons not to teach causal inference. But I like it. That's not the point, but this is not important if whether I like it. Sorry, that was not well said. But
well, maybe I can read out a comment that Danny Kaplan just made. He said, "The point of introducing causal inference is to support decision making. The criterion for success is that better decisions are made with causal analysis than without."
Ooh, one of my idols was listening.
I know. Well done, Danny. All right. Well, we thank you again for this presentation. We thank all of you for coming. We will do our best to get some more information about causal inference out to you. There's some things, like you mentioned, on ECOTS. Some things already available on CauseWeb for you to look at if you're interested in this, and then these slides will be available on ECOTS or on CauseWeb as well for you to look at very shortly. So thanks again to everyone. I hope you all have a good day, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks to you.
Bye-bye.